introduce the next speaker, a National Executive Council member, and the Bishop and President of Full Gospel Church International, Right Reverend S. N. Mensah. Let's put our hands together for him as he takes the podium.
Thank you very much, GS. And also thank you, President, for the opportunity to share and also speak on this important topic. And indeed, we have been blessed by great ministration, great word, and a great moment of prayer. After such a great word, you wonder what exactly are you going to bring out again. But we want to thank God for Dr. Kisef for leading the prayer and Apostle General for that great moment of ministration time. I have been asked to look at the subject, the church and national development. And before I do that, I will engage you in a couple of things. And I have some few news cards that I would like to look at. Okay, I'm looking at the subject, the church and national development. So we are talking about the church, and then we are also talking about national development. I have here a news card by Daily Graphic, September 2003, and captioned "Another Slum in the Making, Growing Fast in the Heart of the Capital City of Ghana is Another Slum Known as Abuja and Called Condemned by Others. This area behind the Cocoa Board head office is densely populated and inhabited mostly by traders who convert their shops, kiosks, and other illegal structures into bedrooms at night. That place is also popular with commercial sex workers and criminal elements who harass innocent citizens. It is another Sodom and Gomorrah in the making, and it may be too late to act by the time the reality dawns on the city planners." This was published by Daily Graphic, September 8, 2003. I'm going to engage you in a couple of questions, and you provide me with some answers. But don't hold on your fire and your bullet and don't shoot me yet, because I'm just going to tread on the particular direction, and then I will build my argument to a point. So in 2003, which government was in office? The NPP, all right, okay. Now, and this newspaper is telling us that a slum just at the Cocoa head office in the capital city, Accra. Now, what kind of institutions are there that could have stopped this slum? So let's talk about it. What are some of the institutions? Yes? The railways police station, right there. Okay, so in other words, the law enforcement agency is one of the institutions that are mandated to stop illegal activities. Yeah. Yet they went to sleep. Yes, what are the institutions? AME. AME, all right? Who are the major managers of the city? They also went to sleep. So we are talking of two institutions, law enforcement, AME. Any other institution? EP, all right, that is the Environmental Protection Agency. They have also gone to sleep, yes? Town and Country Planning, another institution. I'm also looking for one institution that nobody has mentioned yet. Well, the law enforcement, the legislature, okay? We are talking of MPs. At least, they must show some concern and raise this issue in parliament so that something has to stop. They've also gone to sleep. Then, of course, the executive. The president and his cabinet, the executive. So we are talking about institutions that have gone to sleep for illegality to happen. Now, I have another one. September 4th, this was September 8th, this is September 4th, 2003. And the caption is, "This is an eyesore." We are not talking about, you know, any mean newspaper. We are talking of Daily Graphic, a very credible news reporting, you know, authority. This is an eyesore. Now, it is unfortunate that drains at Abosokai, where spare parts dealers operate, have been turned into refuse dump. Hello? Drains have been turned into refuse dump. Apart from the health hazards, which are obvious, the slightest rain would naturally result in flooding and thereby cause damage to property. And who knows? Lives as well will be lost. 2003. Still, we are talking about the MPP government in office. There is also another caption I have, Daily Graphic. Monday, December 5th, 2005. All right, it said, "Check these squatters." 2005, Daily Graphic. "A new slum is springing up in the most unlikely place in Accra, the plush environs of the elitist airport residential area. This situation makes one wonder if there are laws in this country, and who is responsible for their enforcement?" Not long ago, the Ochihini Osajifo Amoetiaro for Repenin said, "Gone were the days when towns and villages had been spaces for rest, recreation, sports, communal meetings, and discussions of issues of public concern. The story today is different and dire. There is hardly any park worthy of description in any part of Accra." That is Osajifo speaking. That's a motive of repenting. "Apart from the Efua Sutherland Children's Park," he said those setbacks could be attributed to the population pressure and sheer lack of good planning. This particular space between Opeabia House and the Golden Tulip in Accra, right in the heart of the capital, is said to become the next Abuja. Remember, I said in 2003, they said Abuja was being introduced, and the reporter said if something was not going to be done, Abuja would be like Sodom and Gomorrah. After 2 years, squatters have created an environment, and now that this reporter, after 2 years, is saying that if care is not taken, it will become like Abuja. In other words, Abuja has not settled down. Are you now hearing? Are you following? So it says it will then become like Abuja or Sodom and Gomorrah, which we can't handle it now, and Abuja we can't handle now. So he said if we don't check these squatters now, in 2005, it will become like another Abuja. "The area has a lot of wooden structures where people live and do business, ranging from aquatician drinking bars to mechanic shops. The conspicuous location of bathrooms in open spaces without proper channel of disposing the wastewater has led to the stagnation of wastewater, leading to the breeding of mosquitoes." Again, these five institutions we mentioned are still in existence, and yet these squatters are having a field day. 2005. And in 2005, which government? NPP, all right. Just don't shoot me yet. Hold on. In June 16, 2009, Daily Graphic, I have written here, leadership problem. Then the caption here is, hawkers have taken over the pavements facing pedestrians onto the streets and creating unnecessary traffic. This congestion is meant to address that. This and he's talking about congestion within the main central Accra area. Right behind it is the police station. And we have all these institutions. This is in 2009. And which government was in power? NDC. All right.
NDC one, Professor Nelson.
Yes. So NDC. All right. Now, Daily Graphic here, January 2012, 14th January 2012. I have here 4.8 million defecate in the open in Ghana. 4.8 million people. Now, Ghana Pentecostal, and that is 20% of the population. Let me just read a little bit. About 4.8 million people in Ghana, 20% of the national population practice open defecation, known in local parlance, free range. A survey conducted by the Ministry of Local Government and Rural Development has revealed the situation is as a result of lack of access to toilet facilities. Officials describe this situation as very serious, especially as the Millennium Development Goals has set a zero open defecation target for 2015. Now, 4.8, 20% of the population have no toilets, they defecate openly. Now, GPCC has a population of close to 25% of the nation's population. So basically, we are about 6 million, if that is the mathematics is correct. Now, it means that almost the entire GPCC congregation defecate publicly. That is the 4.85 million we are talking about. I'm just talking about the sheer numbers so that it will give you a mental picture. Are you hearing me? So can you imagine, I mean, like COP has a total membership population of over about 2 million. All of them, including all the rest of us, 6 million, put together, defecate publicly. Now, this almost 5 million people who defecate publicly are members of your churches. Are members of our churches. They go to church every Sunday. So if they behave this the way they are behaving, what has been the impact of the pulpit? Something for you to think about now. If they behave the way they are behaving, we are talking about the church and national development. And if they behave the way they are behaving, and squatters all over, squatters here, squatters there, squatters everywhere, and they go to our churches, and if the theory is right, 70% of our people are supposed to be Christians, and our Sunday services are filled with people, then what has been the effect of the preaching on the lives of the people? This is something for you to think about. Now, I have Daily Graphic, February 1st, 2014. That was just a few days ago. I have a collection of these articles for the past 20 years. As I make my presentations everywhere to reprove where this nation is heading towards to. February 1st, 2014. It said, Accra underwater after 1 hour rainfall. Just 1 hour rainfall, Accra is underwater. So what happens if it's 5 hours rainfall? And they said it is as a result of choke gutters all over. Accra under rainfall. Which government is in power around January 2014? Favor. So NDC too. All right. Now, Daily Graphic, February 3rd, 2014. Aftermath of the flood. Okay? So the graphic captured when the flood came. And then 2 days later, AME and Zoom Lion call for attitudinal change. Now they have moved this problem from the political doorsteps to the pulpits now. Attitudinal change is more or less the responsibility of the pulpit. Okay? Attitudinal change is more or less the responsibility of the pulpit. So now they are saying that this problem we have in our society has to do with the pulpit now. When Jesus came on the scene, he preached one message. He said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And the word repent means change your attitude, change your belief system, change the way you do things. So the word repent means change your attitude. Change your attitude. And now let me just read a little bit. The Accra Metropolitan Assembly and Zoom Lion Ghana Limited Waste Management Company have warned that Accra will continue to experience flooding if the residents do not change their attitude towards sanitation in the city. If they will not change sanitation in the city. So, these are the challenges we find ourselves. Then finally, the graphic, January 30th, 2014, city in the free fall. It is falling at the speed of 100 kilometers per hour. Okay, so graphic captioned it, city in the free fall. Now, having said that, we need to understand the environment we find ourselves. Okay. We need to find the environment this industry called church is involved in. Whether we like it or not, the church is an industry. Yeah. All right? And so the church is not operating out of, in isolation. So we need to find out the industry, the church. So politically, we are a polarized nation. That is the challenge we find ourselves, to the extent that we carry that excess baggage into our churches. Economically, very unstable economy, city free fall. Socioculturally, AMA have agreed that we have an attitudinal problem in the country, which has moved from political issues to the doorsteps of the pulpit. Now, technologically, by technology, we are an import nation. We only import everything from the toothpick through matchbox to anything at all. We import everything from toothpick. So we are not yet an industrialized nation. We don't manufacture anything. Germany alone have 4 different manufacturing plants of vehicles: BMW, Audi, Mercedes, and a Volkswagen, an Opel, 5. And yet there is space for competition. Just Germany alone. Now, let's look at the environment we find ourselves. We create filth all over. And the people who are creating filth, they speak in tongues. They go to church. So the question is, what impact is the pulpit making in the life of the people? I have been a strong advocate and a strong believer that the pulpit is failing the pew. And the problems of our society, we will examine that. And legal, because we are trying to scan our environment and then understand the industry we are in. If you look at legal, the problem of all that we have established here is as a result of poor enforcement of law and order. By and large, it's an indisciplined society. So now, These problems existed under MPP government. These same problems have existed under NDC problems, under NDC government. Now, the problems our society is facing is not political. The problems of our society and the reason for our underdevelopment has no political color.